For your invitation, and I was asked. Okay, so this one. Okay, I understand. So I was asked to summarize the current status of the numerical relativity simulation for the neutron star merger, and so I very broadly talk about the current status. Okay, so yeah, this is content of my talk. So after a brief introduction, so I'll summarize our understanding for merger and the post-merger of Newton subbinaries based on the numerical simulation. And then finally, so I'd like to talk about what should be done in numerical relativity in this decade. So yeah, sorry, this is my first talk in this year. So I'm not very familiar with the, okay, so. Yeah, anyway, so yeah, first, so let me give some introduction about why so binary Newton star merger and the black hole Newton star merger are interesting. So I think that most of the people who attend this conference know well, but so I repeat what basics. Okay, first, so yeah, first interesting thing is the merger is likely to be resulting a spinning black hole plus massive accretion disk. And we believe that such system around the short gamma ray burst. And this is the first interesting topics. And the second interesting topic is that after the merger, so neutron-rich matter is likely to be ejected. And then so in such a ejector, neutron-rich heavy element, or process elements are likely to be synthesized. And this is the second interesting aspect. And third, so in such a ejector, so unstable R elements shine after the radioactive decay and could be a luminous electromagnetic counterparts of gravitational waves. So this is third interesting aspect. And finally, so post-merger gravitational waves may carry information on nuclear equation state. And this is also a very interesting topic for nuclear physicists. And what is nice is that GW1717 has shown all these aspects, and that means that in the next event, so also perhaps, probably, so we'll enjoy the these aspects again in the next gravitational detections. Okay, so yeah, this is picture is in a sense a summary for the current understanding for the merger remnants. So anyway, so after the merger of neutron star or neutron star black hole or neutron star is formed, which is surrounded by accretion disk in general. And then so during merger, in the two steps, so matter is ejected. So in the first 10 milliseconds, about 10 milliseconds, matter is ejected, the so-called by the dynamical mass ejection. And subsequently, we believe that the matter is ejected from the remnant disk. And we call it such a so subsequent ejector, post-merger ejector. And then, so as I already said, that in the ejector, radioactive activity occurs, and then so subsequently, due to the radioactive decay, so ejector is likely to be shining. And also, of course, we will be able to have a gamma rays. And if we are lucky, so gamma ray burst is likely to be observed. And also associated with the remnant of gamma ray burst, so by the synchrotron radiation, X-ray to radios are likely to be observed. And then, so this is the current understanding. And so our goal is that to understand the quantitative details of this picture by numerical simulation in general relativity. But the theory is not sufficient, and to confirm that our prediction, so we need observation, of course, and that means that we need some prediction for the so electromagnetic signatures and gravitational wave signatures for this so hypothetical predictions. And for the signal, so usually observables driven from the ejector. And specifically here, so observables are kilonova, GRB, and the synchrotron radiation from kilonova and GRB remnants. And then you saw, yeah, so to understand the detail of these observables, we need to first understand the mass ejection and the property of ejector, including gamma ray burst jet. So thus, specifically, so the role of numerical relativity is to clarify how the matter is ejected from the system and to understand the properties of ejector. So property means that the mass, velocity, combustion, and so on. So on. Okay, so in the next section, I will summarize the current understanding of the merger and post-merger process of Newton's subbinaries. So this is a summary picture for remnants of the Newton star mergers, and in this case, so binary Newton star mergers. After broadly speaking, there are two possibilities. After the merger of two neutron stars, if mass of two neutrons, total mass of neutron star, so M is large enough, then so a black hole is promptly formed. And if so neutron star's mass almost equal, then so black hole plus tiny disk is formed. But if we have mass difference, so black hole is likely to be surrounded by disk. On the other hand, if total mass is not large enough, then so at least temporarily we have neutron star, massive neutron star. And if mass is not very small, then so such a hypermassive neutron star eventually collapses the black hole. But during the evolution process of the such hypermassive neutron star, we usually have a disk with mass 1% to 10% of the solar mass. And if mass is extremely, so very small, then so we could have the so-called supermassive neutron star. That means that that neutron star doesn't collapse too immediately. And perhaps due to the electromagnetic emission like magnetic dipole radiation, then so eventually such neutron star collapses the black hole, but the time scale to the collapse is much longer. And this is a summary of the fate of the binary neutron star merger, and I think that this is a well established picture for the entire fate of the binary neutron star merger. And this is a summary for the black hole neutron star binary, and in this case, so fate is very simple. So we have only two possibilities. In one case, so neutron star is simply swallowed by black hole, and then so isolated black hole remains as a remnant. By contrast, if a neutron star is tidally disrupted by a black hole, then so black hole is surrounded by disk like this, and then so so this is an interesting object which can be observed through the electromagnetic signals. And many simulations has been done by François Fouque and Kotaro Kyutoka, and current understanding is that if high black hole spin is high or black hole mass is low, tidal disruption occurs. But if, for example, if we have a typical black hole mass, say 10 solar mass with a zero spin, so then so black hole, so neutron star is not tidally disrupted. So for this case, so we need a special condition. So, okay, so anyway, so in the last two slides show that except for the particular case, so in general, so we could have the black hole surrounded by disk, neutron star surrounded by disk. So also in this case, black hole surrounded by disk. So then, so based on these pictures, so we can have two possibilities for the mass ejection during merger and the post-merger process. So in the first mass ejection is the so-called dynamical mass ejection, which occurs soon after the merger due to the shock heating or tidal effect of two objects. And as I said, subsequently, typically, central object is surrounded by disk, and then so from the disk, matter is ejected. And also during evolution of these systems, so gamma ray burst is likely to be emitted. So anyway, so we have, except for the gamma ray burst, we have two mass ejection processes, dynamical mass ejection and the post-merger mass ejection. And for this process, in particular for the post-merger evolution process, so in the last 5 or 10 years, so we have understood that neutron irradiation from, in particular, massive neutron star, also from disk, play a very important role for determining the property of ejector. Also today, so I would like to emphasize that the weak interaction in the disk determines the property of ejector. And so until quite recently, this effect is not well understood, but recently, I think that we have understood the world, the very, very importance of the weak interaction process for kilonova and the nuclear systems. So in the later half, I would like to emphasize this effect. Okay, anyway, so let me summarize the dynamical ejector first. And so many numerical relativity simulations have been done since 2013. And then I think that this process is well understood, at least qualitatively. And the fact we have learned is as follows. So mass is about 0.1% to 1% solar mass for neutron star binary neutron stars. And for binary black hole neutron star binary, so this can be 0.1 solar mass if neutron star is tidally disrupted. Of course, if a neutron star is not tidally disrupted, ejector mass is zero. And the average velocity is roughly speaking the equal to the escape velocity from neutron star. So I mean that it's about 20% of the speed of light for binary neutron star. But for some component, this could be 0.9 C. This is due to the shock heating effect play an important role for dynamical mass ejection. For black hole neutron star case, this is between 0.1 to 2.4 C typically. And for black hole neutron star case, we usually don't have a high velocity component. And the electron fraction is broadly distributed. For binary neutron star, it is between the 0.05 to 0.4. By contrast, for black hole neutron star binary, it is very small usually. The reason is that for binary neutron star case, shock heating effect play a very important role. So I mean that by the shock heating effect, the temperature increase and this affects the rod about the weak interaction process. By contrast, for black hole neutron star case, tidal disruption occurs, so mass ejection occurs simply due to the tidal effect. And then in such case, so weak interaction play a minor role. Of course, these quantities depends on the binary parameters and the equation state. So quantitatively, more research is necessary, but qualitatively, I think that we reached a consensus. And then, yeah, this is a summary for the dynamical ejector. So I classified four cases. So for the case of supramassive neutron star formation, hypermassive neutron star formation, prompt black hole formation, and the black hole neutron star merger with tidal disruption. As this second row shows that the mass and the ejector YE and the velocity depend strongly on the component of mass and spin. But anyway, so irrespective of the these parameters, finally, small YE component is ejected and the ejector is likely to be lantern rich. And depending on the mass of ejector, luminosity of a kilonova change, but anyway, so in this from this component, we have the red kilonova. So I think that we reached a consensus about this. But by contrast, for the post-merger ejector, we haven't reached a consensus. Anyway, so let me summarize how the post-merger ejector is driven. So neutron star is likely to be strongly magnetized before the merger. So then, so remnant neutron star or accretion disk also magnetized. And the magnetic field is amplified by magnetohydrodynamics instabilities. For example, for neutron star binary neutron stars, Kelvin-Helmholtz instability play a role for amplification. And also in the disk, magnetorotational instability play an important role for amplification. And then so naturally, turbulence is likely to be excited. And then effective viscosity is enhanced. And then so effective viscosity determines the subsequent post-merger evolution and mass ejection. So first, this was first pointed out by Fernandez and Metzger. And also, so nowadays, so there are a couple of the MHD simulations and which show that not only the effective viscous effect, so MHD, other MHD effect play an important role. And also several work show that Newtonian radiation plays an important role, in particular in the presence of the neutron star. And also, so detailed weak interaction physics play a very important role for evolution of the system and for determining the YE and the nuclear synthesis. Okay, so this is a very rough summary for the how the disk is evolved. And anyway, so roughly speaking, disk evolution is controlled by the neutron luminosity and the viscous evolution. For the early phase, disk temperature is very high. So typically temperature is 10 MeV or something like this. Then in such case, so neutron luminosity is very high. And in this case, so viscous heating energy generation rate is approximately equal to the neutrino cooling rate. So then in such case, so neutron heat and viscous heating is cannot be used for the mass ejection. However, neutron luminosity depends very steeply on the temperature. And then, so if temperature drops below about 3 MeV, so neutron luminosity is far below the energy generation rate by the viscous heating. And after this phase, so mass ejection occur from the torus or disk. Of course, so MHD effect may play a role. But this is a basic picture. And I mean that in the presence of the MHD effect, so mass ejection, onset time of mass ejection could be earlier. But anyway, so basically, so disk expansion is quite slow. So this is a viscous time scale, and this is roughly speaking several hundred milliseconds. This is a much longer than the orbital period. Orbital period is less than 10 milliseconds for this case. And this is a very basic picture for the mass ejection from the torus. But the property of the ejector depends on the detail of microphysics. So before 2019, the picture is quite simple. So in the presence of a neutron star, due to the strong neutron irradiation from the neutron star, neutron richness of ejector is reduced because of neutron absorption process. And then, so if a neutron luminosity is approximately the same, so then so fraction proton to neutron is approximately towards the same value, then so ejector is likely to be likely to have the high YE, and then so in the nuclear synthesis, in such case, our process nuclear synthesis doesn't occur efficiently and poor lanthanoid, and then so opacity for such ejector is likely to be low. This is naive consideration. By contrast, for the case of black hole, so we don't have the strong neutron irradiation source. Of course, we have a disk, then so neutron irradiation is present, but it's weak. And then in such case, we believe that the YE is low and lanthanoid is synthesized. And then so ejector is likely to be optically sick. However, so recent more careful numerical simulation indicates that this is not correct. In particular, so paper by Oliver used to summarize where what is the problem. And I think that this paper is very nice and I recommend to read his paper. Yeah, anyway, so more details are like this. So anyway, so we have several new weak interaction process. One is, of course, as I said, that Newton absorption. And in the presence of the neutron absorption, and in such case, we have the fully beta equilibrium like this. And then, as I said, then in such case, YE moved to the 0.5. So I mean that the neutron richness become very weak. This is only very important for the case that the temperature is very high. So I mean that only for the case that the neutron luminosity is very high, this is very important. So in the typical situation, in particular in the absence of the neutron star, neutron reaction decouple fast, but still there is a electron positron capture process. And this process is written like this. And this is always very efficient if the temperature is fairly high. Fairly high is that even if the temperature is 2 or 3 MeV, this work. So that means that by this process, electron fraction change with time. And the recent more careful simulation shows that this process is efficient until the maximum temperature of disk become below the about 3 MeV. Until this this temperature, this work very this is a very important process. And the fact is important is that the electron generation is also very important because the disk is very disk density is very high. Then so usually in the first so initial stage, electron is degenerate, and then so in such case, electron fraction is very low. But with the decrease of density due to the viscous expansion, Y increase. So that means that during this process work, gradually Y increase, but eventually Y saturate. This is a one result. Okay, so in this case, time proceed, electron fraction increase like this, and eventually weak interaction process freeze, and then Y value freeze like this. And anyway, so this is a time at which that weak interaction time scale is longer than the disk expansion time scale. But this timing depends on, the, of course, how quickly disk expand. For the case that the high viscosity, so disk expand quickly and then so freeze earlier. But if a viscosity is not very high, so disk gradually expands, then so freeze out time is delayed, and then so eventual Y is higher. So anyway, so this shows that the electron. So this electron capture is very important. I mean that the weak interaction process is very important. Also, mass ejection time scale is also very important. There are two important factors for determining the YE in this system. Okay, so I don't have enough time, so I skip. Anyway, so depending on the final value of YE, so fractions, the heavy adverse elements also change. Okay, anyway, so this is summary. So current understanding the current question. We need to correct into account the weak physics. In the absence of correct weak physics, so we could have the incorrect electron fraction, and we could have the incorrect nucleosynthesis result. And also another important factor is the onset time of mass ejection. In the absence of a MHE process, so this onset time is determined by the viscous time scale, which is fairly long. In this case, so because of long time scale, we will not have the heavy adverse element, and then so randomly poor ejector is a result. But in the presence of the MHE process, this time scale could be even much shorter, as this simulation has been shown. In such case, so we could have a rich lanthanoid. But caution is that for these simulations, so they perform the simulation for the black hole and the disk. But so we don't know that the fact is a natural configuration for a disk magnetic field. And usually, so people give a artificial polar field. And in such case, so matter is spuriously ejected. And it's not very clear that which is artificial effect, which is real effect. Anyway, so this is a summary. So the current summary for the post-merger ejector, we know where the mass and velocity, but we don't know where that how large is the electron fraction, how small is the electron fraction. This value, so minimum value, depends on the mass ejection timing, and which is determined by the importance of the magnetic field effect. So then, so this is my conclusion. Yeah, what should we do in this decade? So this is a summary for the important time scale. So anyway, so as I talked, there are three time scales. One is a dynamical mass ejection time scale, which is very short. So for this, it's very easy to perform a simulation. For post-merger mass ejection time scale is very long. So typically 1 to 10 seconds. And short gamma ray burst time scale is up to 2 seconds. So this time scale shows that for the self-consistent studies of for merger and post-merger, we need a simulation of duration at least 2 seconds. And as I said, image effects are likely to be the key. And weak interaction process should be taken into account as precisely possible. So this is our conclusion. And then so due to this conclusion, we just started a very long term simulation. And this is a preliminary result, but I think that in the future, this committee should perform this kind of simulation. Here, so this is a simulation from black hole neutron star with a high black hole spin and density and the B field and the B over rho. Anyway, so yeah, this is a summary slide. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much.